All right. I was wondering if this was on or not. Everybody seemed like, I know the music was kind of lulling everybody to sleep right before we started. I told them we should play something loud with a heavy beat, but it might cause a heart attack, so we better not. Fun stuff. Welcome back. Is anybody here this week that wasn't here last week? All right. We got a few here this week that weren't here last week. Welcome back. I'm so glad that you're here. So let me just go over a couple things real fast. You noticed that I had a mask on a few moments ago, but I took it off because I want you to be able to hear me, right? And so I'm a distance away. Masks are perfectly acceptable. If you feel comfortable wearing it, wear it. If you don't, that's okay. That's up to you. You notice the pews are spaced out. We do that to make sure that last week, you may notice that the pew that maybe you sat on last week is closed this week. And the reason for that is we alternate it every week to make sure that we sanitize and we give it a chance to rest so that no germs are left behind. We are very much intent on killing germs, and so we want to make sure we do that. You notice you didn't receive a bulletin when you came in. There won't be any kind of bulletin paperwork-wise, so you'll have to get your announcements from the Facebook site, the website, or the screen when you come in, so you can get all of that through that. And then if you have offering today and you weren't here, so you don't know how things go, we're trying to limit the passing of the plate and all of that. So right outside in the foyer, there's a little glass box that says blessed. It's right there as you go out the door where the old hand sanitizer thing used to be. And so we just ask you to just go ahead and drop your offering in there. So in a moment, we'll have a time of welcome and whatever. If you have offering, you hadn't put it in, please go ahead and do so they'll be counting it very shortly. So that's where we're going to be doing that. And we'll continue to do that for the time being. We'll make changes as we go. As we see that we can, we'll do different things. But right now, we're continuing with morning service only. Our 10:45 worship service is the only service that the adults are having during the week. And then our students are having their evening service on Wednesday evening, and that's the only service that they're having. So we will continue to take a look at everything, see how things are progressing, and as we feel safe to do so, we will begin opening other services, and we'll try to get back to as much normal as we can. But we're going to continue to do this for a little while. So just keep all of that in mind, and we're trying to make sure everybody stays safe. So it is so good to see everybody today. I'm excited today. Brother J.R. trimmed his beard. Man, I mean, he did that for me, I know. I'm just teasing. Just teasing. I love you, brother. And I'm glad that you're here. I really am. And so I'm excited for everybody to be back, and I am. I talked about the loud music and whatever. I'm more excited for being back in here than I could ever be for football season or something like that. This is just an amazing thing for us to finally be back together. But don't forget, we're still broadcasting. Hopefully it's going out live right now. We had a little problem last week when we tried to do the live. It kind of quit on us. And so we're trying to keep that going. So if you're out in web land watching, we're so glad to have you today as well. Thanks for joining in. And so we'll have a lot of things to talk about, but I just wanted to say, glad to see you. Welcome today. And for all of the fathers out here, happy Father's Day. We're going to continue on with our service. I'm going to turn it over to Miss Vicki for right now. And good to see everybody today.
Thankfully, the choir knows this opening, so let's stand and worship the Lord, and let's just praise Him this morning.
King of kings, Lord of lords, bright
right. Amen. So again, this morning, I'm so excited that you're here. And so we're going to take this opportunity to open up with a word of prayer. And after we do that, I encourage you to turn around and wave at everybody and welcome them. And we'll have the children will come at the same time. So let's pray. Father, we do come to you today and thank you so much for the blessings. God, we are absolutely blessed. There's no other way to say it. We are a blessed people, Father, knowing that you are in control. Father, when things seem so out of control, it's just a reminder that we didn't have control in the first place. You do. And so, Father, we pray that you would just be with us today. During this time, God, we just ask that you be seen high and lifted up in this place. Father, thank you for allowing us to be together in this place today. And Father, we thank you so much for Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, the hope that we all have. And Father, we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, if you will, go ahead and turn around, wave at each other, all the things that you do. And it's time for 4 years old through fourth grade. Come on down. It's your time to stop on the steps. Good morning. Good morning. How are you today? Well, that's so wonderful. I'm so glad to have you ladies here this morning. I'm glad to have you come and stop on the steps with me. So, what happens now? What do I usually do now? I do. That's what I usually do. I ask a question. I heard somebody whisper it to you. Did you hear them? Yes, I heard them too. But that's good. You got the answer, right? Okay, so here is the question. Do you know what this is? Now do you know what this is? Okay. It's not a pen. Do you know what that is? What is this? It's a shot. It's a needle for taking shots, right? So would you like me to give you a shot today? No. Why not? Shots hurt or shots bad? Have you had shots before? Have you had shots before?
No.
You do. You just don't remember. I'm glad you don't remember, but you had shots. You know, when you're little and you go to the doctor, they have certain shots you have to take. And when you're really little, they stick them in your leg. And sometimes they put them in your arm. And they put those shots in. And we all can agree, right? Shots are bad, right? We don't like shots. But you know what? There's something that we have to think about. Why do we get shots? Do you get shots because you're sick?
I don't know.
Do you get shots to keep you from getting sick? Yes. You get shots sometimes to keep you from getting sick. So there's diseases out there that if you take the shot, it can help you not get it. Sometimes when you're sick and you're really bad sick and they need to give you some medicine in a hurry, they give you a shot. So yes, shots hurt. And nobody likes shots. Nobody likes to take a shot. But I don't think, does anybody out here like to take shots? Okay, just double checking. Nobody likes to take shots, but why? Because they hurt, don't they? Shots hurt when they poke that needle in. It hurts, so we don't like to do that. But did you know that medicine that they give you and the quick way that they can put it in a shot can help you feel better real soon? So even though that shot seems bad, it works together for a good purpose to make you feel better real soon, to keep you from being super sick and to keep you from getting even worse, right? So sometimes things that seem bad can actually be used for good, right? And so I want you to remember that God uses all things for good for those that love the Lord, even though sometimes they may seem bad. Okay? You got it? You remember? All right. So you still don't want a shot? Okay. Oh, I won't give you one then. We'll save that for another time. All right. No, we won't really give you a shot. Just teasing. All right. Let's say prayer. Remember how we pray? And then we're going to let you go back to mom and dad. Let's pray. Father, we come to you today, and I do thank you for these children. Father, it is hard to understand sometimes why something that seems so bad, Father, is necessary. But sometimes it is. Father, it's necessary because it's in your plan for things to go a certain way. And Father, your word does tell us that you work all things together for good for those that love the Lord. And so, Father, we trust in that. In everything, I pray that you will remind these children, Father, that even though sometimes things seem bad, God, you work all things together for good for those who love the Lord. We thank you. We ask that today you be glorified, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right.
Dad, for showing me the Father. I see His love in everything you do. Like a clear reflection in the water, I've always seen the Father. Could see His loving ways became so familiar. 'Cause Dad, you made the Father real to me. Thank you, Dad, for showing me the Father. I see His love in everything you do, like a clear reflection in the water, I've always seen the Father in you. You sang the grand old hymns and read the stories. Bended knee, following your steps, I met the Father, and His amazing grace now lives in me. So thank you, Dad, for showing me the Father. Like a clear reflection in the water, I've always seen the Father in you. You let me see the Father in you.
And we just want to wish a happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there today. And we thank Brother Don for that this morning. He said he had to do the video or else he just couldn't make it through. What a tribute. And so we thank you for that. And now we're just going to continue to thank our Heavenly Father this morning by singing praises to Him this morning. If you'll stand, if you'd like to. Otherwise, please stay seated. Thank you, choir.
Majesty.
Amen. Isn't that how it should be? We stand in awe of our Heavenly Father. In awe. You know, because it's an amazing thing when you go through life and you know your Heavenly Father. He never, ever ceases to amaze you. Just when you thought you had seen everything and you know that He had been through you, with you and all of the things that you've been through, then suddenly something else comes along and you're just amazed again at the blessings that our Father gives. We're amazed at the things that happen. I do stand in awe of my Heavenly Father because there have been so many things in my life that I just know it's God. And there's no doubt, and it just is amazing. Even when I know that I've not been the person I should be, still, God is there. And He's so I'm very excited today that we get to share together in the worship of our amazing God. Today, the title of our message is All Things for Good. All Things for Good. That's the next installment in the Purpose series, is All Things for Good. And so, as we have talked about last week, the number one and number two most searched for verses on different scripture websites was Jeremiah 29:11. The third most searched for scripture on Bible Gateway is Romans chapter 8 and verse 28. Can anybody guess where we're going to be today? Romans chapter 8 and verse 28. So go ahead and turn with me to Romans chapter 8 and verse 28. Romans chapter 8 and verse 28. This is the third most searched for verse on Bible Gateway, which is a website in which people look up scripture. And so a lot of people are looking up what this scripture says. A lot of people want to know. Why? Because there are a lot of people going through a lot of bad things and they're trying to figure out what does it mean. So they're searching this scripture, and the scripture simply says, "And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose." And that is the New American Standard Bible. So we look at that today. And what I want us to really grab a hold to there is God causes all things to work together for good. All things to work together for good. Now, what I want us to be cautious about is I want to be careful to see that God didn't say all things are good. God didn't say all things are good. He never said that, listen, when you accept Jesus as your Savior, from that point on, your life will be good. There's nowhere that Scripture says that. In fact, Scripture tells us that we will have trouble in this world. The Scripture says they rejected Jesus, why not you? Right? And so in all of these things that we're looking at and we're understanding that all things are not good. And when we read this verse, people are looking through this verse, and when we read it, don't misread it to say God says all things are good, because that's not so. If you believe that all things are going to be good in your life, when a bad thing comes, you're devastated. Because how could God, who says He loves you so much, allow something bad to come into your life? Instead of looking at that, look at the actual verse that says God causes all things to work together for good. So the things that come into our life, God uses them and works them together for good. He causes those things to work together. So we want to be careful that we don't think that this verse says all things are good. Because sometimes things that aren't very good can work together to make things good. Sometimes things that aren't very good can work together to make things good, right? A shot. The dreaded needle. I know that every one of us in here as children, we were excited to find out we were getting a shot when we went to the doctor, right? We all were so excited. Hey, I'm getting a shot. Now, we might like the lollipop after. You know, you got to get a lollipop after you go through that trauma, right? But we didn't like the shot. Nobody liked the shot. By the way, if you're wondering, why does the pastor have a needle? These were allergy shots, by the way. So all things can work together, and they do work together to make things good. A shot hurts. Ask any child. They will tell you that a shot isn't good. Any child will tell you that. If you listen, it don't have to be a child. I can go around the room and say, how many adults think that a shot isn't good? And many of us said, I don't want a shot. I don't want that. They hurt. Why do I have to have a shot? Do you have it in pill form? Can I just take a pill? A pill would be so much easier to do whatever it is that has to be done. You know, sometimes you go to the doctor and you're really sick. And they say, well, we want to give you an antibiotic shot. And you say, don't you just have that in a pill? Well, yes, we have it in a pill. But the pill's going to take 3 or 4 days to actually start really doing any good. And the shot can begin to work immediately. Most of the time, if we're really sick, we say, where are you going to stick me? I'm going to take the shot. Where is it? Where are you going to put it? Because I want to get well soon, and so I'm willing to take that bad thing in order to know that it's going to work together for something good. A shot hurts. We know that. However, the medicine in the shot, the medicines that are administered, are good. The medicines are good. Also, the expeditious way, the speed at which it's delivered, the quick delivery method through the shot is good, because sometimes when we do that, that quick delivery method can make sure that we begin to heal right away. Now, it wasn't a good thing, but it all came together for good, and because of being able to get a shot that hurts, the medicine was delivered, we got the right medicine, and we began to feel better very quickly. So when we are examining these things, then it kind of helps us to see that it all works together. The shot, the medicine, they all come together in one thing, so that two good things come together through one bad thing, right? And those two good things that come together through one bad thing makes it work together for good. Now, some of you are sitting out here and you're going, today's Father's Day, right? He hadn't even talked about fathers. Don't we get a Father's Day message on Father's Day? I mean, we're supposed to have a message directed to fathers on Father's Day, right? Okay, happy Father's Day to all you fathers out there. No, I really mean that. Happy Father's Day to all you fathers out there. Too many times in today's society, we have come to a point where we expect certain things at certain times, and if it's not that way, it messes us up, right? Well, we don't get that. What happened? We should get that. Understand, this message is for fathers and mothers and brothers and sisters and children and single adults. It's for everybody. The message is for everybody. But fathers, I want to point out some special things to you today about this message. I want you to understand this. We're talking about this purpose. We're talking about things that sometimes are bad that work for good. Dads, we're called by God to be the leader of our families. Understand that. Now listen to me closely. We are called not by the president. We're not called by the church. We're not called by our parents. We're called by God, men. We're called by God to be the leaders of our families. That includes being the spiritual leader and the physical leader of our families. We are called by God to do that. Now, I know that there are some that say, well, you know, this whole the man is the head of the house thing, that's old-fashioned. Well, it's still in Scripture. As long as it's still in Scripture, it means that God put it there. And if God said that's the way it's supposed to be, then listen, that's how it's supposed to be. God created us men to be the leaders of our families, both physically and spiritually. And as the leaders of our families, we have to answer to God. We have to answer to God, not the world, but we answer to God. And when we answer to God, here's the thing. Sometimes the decisions that we have to make aren't good. Sometimes decisions that we have to make aren't good. How many dads out there can say, the first time I spanked my child, I cried as hard as they did? I'm not, me and you, Brother Don, I guess. Oh, there's another one. Most of us fathers, the first time we had to spank our child, it hurt our feelings. But we knew it was something that had to be done. We knew there was discipline that had to happen. And the discipline was going to work together for something that would be good. And so, fathers, we had to make a tough decision. We had to make a tough decision to do that. The first time that, you know, you had to give your child medication and they didn't want it. Oh, they cried and they didn't want it, but you had to give it to them anyway. The first time you had to say no. No. They, oh, how they cry. They wanted it so badly, and you had to be the one to say no. But that was a decision that you had to make. Sometimes the decisions that you make aren't good. But we make them for the overall good. We make those decisions for the overall good. So even though it was a decision that we didn't want to make, we didn't want to have to do that, whatever it was, we knew that for the overall good, that decision had to be made. That sometimes they have to go through hard things in order to learn the good things and how they come. Listen, one of the hardest things that as a father, one of the hardest things that I had to do is make a decision to have my sweet little girl, well, sometimes she's sweet, sweet little girl running around and everybody just loved to watch her do this. Everywhere she went, she was on her tiptoes. It was so cute. Everybody said, oh, she's practicing for high heels later. You know, she's going to be a ballerina. She's always on her toes. But there came a time when she couldn't not walk on her toes. And one of the hardest things I ever had to do is decide that we were going to have to do surgery. Now, you and I have to make decisions sometimes about having surgery. And we understand all of the things about surgery. But my little girl wasn't ready for those kind of decisions, so they had to be made for her. And one of the hardest things was to make a decision that she has to have surgery. And when she came out of that surgery screaming and crying in so much pain and everything else, oh, I thought, did I make the bad choice? Did I make the wrong decision? She's going through all of this awful stuff, but you know, today she can walk around flat-footed. Today she can run normally. There are things she can do now that she couldn't do while she was walking around on her toes. It was a hard decision to make. It was a lot of pain she went through. It was a lot of pain we went through too, right? A lot of pain that we went through, a lot of pain that happened, but it was a decision that had to be made, and it wasn't something that was easy. But we made the decision for the greater good, for the overall good. Because we know that sometimes things come together for good even when they don't seem good up front. Listen, our Heavenly Father does the very same thing. Our Heavenly Father does the very same thing. He allows us things that aren't good. Sometimes He allows us things that aren't good in our lives. Sometimes there are things that happen and we don't understand why. We don't understand why. Why do I have to deal with this disease? Why do I have to deal with this injury? Why do I have to deal with this certain thing in my life? Why do I have to do that? I can't tell you that. I don't know why you have to deal with that, except that God has a plan. He has a purpose. And it's because of His purpose that sometimes things that come into our lives aren't good. They're not good. We would never look at it and say, it is good. When I was a teenager in high school, I guess my junior year of high school, my mother was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. Just out of the blue. What happened? She suddenly got multiple sclerosis. I didn't fully understand what all that meant. I knew that there were things Mom wasn't going to be able to do. I knew there were things that were going to continue to deteriorate. But you know, God blessed and he allowed her to stay in remission for a very, very long time. Only in the last 5-6 years has she really begun to progress in a negative way again. And even that has been very slow. So we're very blessed with all of that that's happened. But I would never have wanted to see my mother go through the things she went through with multiple sclerosis. But I can tell you this. She will tell you today, if you ask her, if you could go back and do your life and not have multiple sclerosis, would you choose to do that? And she'll tell you, absolutely not. She said, I would not. Because God has used that in my life to allow me to be able to connect and to witness to people that I never would have been able to witness to had I not been stricken with the same disease they had. God allowed something that was bad came into her life, but he worked it together for good. Even though she deals with it, she still deals with things. God worked it together for good. There are things that come into our life. Sometimes God allows these things in our life, and we look at it and we say, why? We don't understand this. Sometimes he allows us things that aren't good, but he causes even these things to work together for good for those that love the Lord. He causes even those bad things to work together for good for those who love the Lord. Now, we can't stop with that passage of Scripture and say God causes all things to work together for good, end of Scripture, because it's not the end. There's another part of that Scripture, and it says good for those who love the Lord, right? That's what it says. Now, some of you are listening to all of this today, and you're saying, you know, at the beginning of today, you told us this was another installment in the series of Purpose. So, Purpose? You're talking about a lot of things. We haven't really heard purpose very much. We haven't heard purpose. Well, I guarantee you, this is a series on purpose, even if you're not sure. So look at the rest of that passage of Scripture. The rest of that passage of Scripture says, according to his purpose. According to his. That's why it's highlighted. His purpose, not mine. It's not according to my purpose. If it was according to my purpose, it would be a perfect life. I would never want anything negative to happen in my life, ever. I'd want it always to be good. But I never would have had the blessings I've had in my life had that been the case. Because God uses, he works all things together for good for those who love the Lord according to his purpose. It's according to his purpose. It also says in there, for those who are called. According to his purpose. If he has called you to be his child, it's according to his purpose. I would want everything perfect. But as I look back, some of the greatest things that have happened in my life came out of something that seemed terrible to begin with. Things that seemed like they were awful and it never should be. And we didn't want something like that to happen. I think back just a really quick example. I think back to I got married on the 18th of August in the year 1990. If you know your history and you think about what was going on in that time in 1990, there was a man by the name of Saddam Hussein that was getting kind of crazy and over in the Southwest Asia. And a lot of things going on. Well, I got married on the 18th of August. On the 19th of August, somebody knocked on the hotel room door. Who is knocking on our door? Opened the door, there's a state trooper standing there. Then he asked me this terrible question, are you Sergeant Reek? I want to say no. Got the wrong door, fella. I couldn't say no. Yes, I'm sorry to tell you, you're going to have to go home. Your unit has been called to active duty. You got to go home. So, found out it actually wasn't my unit. It was one of the ones that I did all the administration for. But just a couple months later, it was my unit. Got called to active duty. My wife was living in a town. She didn't know anybody. She wasn't plugged in. We weren't plugged into a church at the time. Nothing, everything. It was kind of a bad situation. But you know, through that time, we learned that the two people that we had to rely on the absolute most was each other and God. Those were the ones that we had to rely on the most. There wasn't any running home to mom and dad. There wasn't any taking care of it other way. It was a bad situation. But you know what? God caused us to draw so much closer together through that, that this year we'll be celebrating our 30th wedding anniversary. What a wonderful thing. I would never have asked for that, but God knew what He was doing. According to His purpose, He works all things together for good. All things together. So, we have to remember that the purpose in everything we do is for Him and not for us. The purpose in everything we do is for Him and not for us. He works all things together for good for His purpose. All things together for good for His purpose. And He is the architect that knows everything. Anybody ever walk through a new construction that just really got started? You walk into this new construction and there's stuff everywhere, people working. There's 2x4s that are up. There's studs here and there. There's things, pipes coming out of the wall, electrical wires all over the place. And you're standing there looking at all that. And I don't know about you, but I can't stand in the middle of all that and see what it's going to be. But these people called architects and these builders that work together on all this, listen, they can stand there and go, oh, yeah, see, right over here is going to be a bathroom. You see, the shower will be there, the toilet here. All this is going to be this way, and over here is going to be the meeting room, and this is going to be, you know, and everything, they can see it all. I'm looking at all of it going, I just see a bunch of mess laying around everywhere. I don't know what that is. That's kind of how it is in our life. God looks at the design and the purpose that He has for our life, and He works all the things that are happening, even though some of them don't seem to be too good. He works all those things that are happening together for His purpose. Because He's the master builder. He's the one that knows exactly how He wants it to turn out. And sometimes, in order for us to turn out exactly how He wants us to be, and maybe only for a certain time, He has to allow things to shape us in a direction that we need to go. Years ago, they redid Mobile Infirmary Hospital. I used to come into Mobile Infirmary, and I turned down one long hallway and went straight all the way down to the atrium. And then all of a sudden, I come in one day, and there's a wall there. Well, now how do I get there? And I started looking everywhere, trying to figure it out. Well, all they did was move that hallway out more toward the front, and they put some other offices in there and closed off some walls, so you kind of went all the way around to get there. But I had to stop and ask somebody, how do I get there from here? Because you've closed off the walls, and it forced me to go another direction. God allows things in our life to close off the walls and force us to go in a different direction. And sometimes the wall that's put up is bad. Sometimes it seems to us that it's the most awful thing that's ever happened in our life. Right now in our tiny little world, there are bad things happening. There are bad things happening. There's a pandemic going on. Y'all heard of that, right? There's a pandemic going on. That's bad. There's racial unrest all over the world. That's bad. There's so many things that are happening in our world that are causing all kinds of problems, and it seems bad. It all seems to come together. I saw somebody put on Facebook, if 2020 were a year, it would look like this, and it showed a picture of mayhem from the Allstate commercials, right? So mayhem is a terrible year. All these awful things that have happened, for crying out loud, they're talking about canceling college football season. I mean, that's bad. There's bad things going on in our world right now. But listen, out of those bad things that are going on, you know, there's some amazing things that have happened. Think about this. Maybe you've heard of families like this. Maybe you've been part of one. Maybe you've even are currently part of one. There's a family where dad's so busy trying to take care of the family to make sure they have everything they need that he's never there, because he's constantly working. He's constantly away from home, constantly doing everything. And maybe in his mind he's thinking, I'm doing all this for the family, but the family just wants him to be home. And now suddenly we all have to stay at home. And relationships that had been maybe not broken, but certainly strained, have now been able to be rebuilt. Children and fathers have and mothers have been able to rebuild that connection. We learned what home-cooked food tastes like again. Because you had to cook. You couldn't do anything else, right? There's a lot of good things that have come out of people having to stay at home. Agencies and corporations have figured out, you know what? We don't even have to rent an office space to have our employees come to work. They can do the same job from home. Suddenly there are jobs that never were work from home jobs that now will be, allowing people more opportunity to be able to do things they couldn't do in the past. You know, you look across our world and our environment, there's cities that were in such bad shape as far as pollution and smog and all of the things that had happened and all of that. They're looking around, they're saying the air quality in some of these cities that has been awful for years is better than it's been in a very long time. Why? Because nobody's driving anywhere. There's nobody driving anywhere. There's no cars on the road. There's a lot of the machines that are being used for construction and that sort of thing have gone quiet, and the emissions are not being put out anymore. So a lot of that has gotten better. You say, well, what about all of this racial tension, all of that stuff that's going on? What can you see good in that? What I can see good in that is that people, for the first time, maybe in many, many years, are understanding there is a problem. There is a problem. We have to address the problem. We have to look at that and understand that all of this racial tension that's coming up right now, while all of the riots and the things that are going on are not good, it's good that people are giving it the attention and beginning to look at it. You know, they said one of the things that people have been searching more than anything else on Google in the last several weeks is they look up, this is what they type in, am I a racist? Why are they typing in, am I a racist? Because they're beginning to question the way they have lived their life. Have I lived my life in a way that I was treating people badly that weren't like me? I didn't think so, but maybe I was doing it and not realizing it. Maybe it was just part of my life. I never thought about it. We need to consider that. It's an important thing for us to understand. God made every single one of us in His image, and we have to love our neighbor as ourselves. We have to share God's love with everybody. Maybe this is the pivotal moment in our country when we can come together and spread the love of God across all different races of people, because really and truly, there's only one race, the human race. The human race. Bad things have been happening, but God works all things together for good for those who love the Lord. Do you know Him today? If you do, listen to that. Understand that He works those things together for that reason. There are things that are happening across our world and we consider it bad. And it is bad. I'm not making light of that. I'm not saying that it's something that is good, but I'm saying that even though what we don't see, God is working those things together. We see things happening as bad, but God is certainly using them to work together for a greater good. He's using them in ways that maybe we didn't even understand. He's using them for His good purpose. For His purpose. Fathers, we all make mistakes with our children. Right? I'm not the only one. All fathers, we make mistakes with our children. I should have, taught my children to answer to my every whim, and that way I wouldn't. No, I'm teasing. We all make mistakes with our children. We really do. My daughter has a shirt. I don't know really what she means by this, but on the shirt it says, you couldn't handle me even if I came with instructions. And I looked at her shirt and I went, that's true. And the problem is you don't come with instructions. I don't know what to do. So yes, fathers, we all make mistakes raising our children. But here's the thing. You have to trust God. You made mistakes, but are you doing what He told you? Are you being the spiritual leader? Are you being the physical leader of your home? Are you trying to do everything that you can to be that leader that God has called you to be? If you are, you're going to make mistakes. But when you make mistakes, trust God that He will use even our mistakes to come together for good. Purpose. What is the purpose? God's purpose is that everything He uses together for good for those who love the Lord, who are called according to His purpose. If He has called you, He's called you according to His purpose. You say, well, He's never called me. I don't think I'm supposed to be a preacher. I'm not talking about that calling. The calling I'm talking about, have you felt that calling to Him call you to be His child? Have you been called to be a son or a daughter of God? Have you been called to give your life to Him? Has that ever happened in your life? So the biggest question is, do you trust God to work all things together for good? Do you trust God? Well, do you know Jesus? Do you know Jesus? Have you given your life to Him? If you have, all things are for good for those who love God. All things together for that. Pardon me. But do you know Him? You see, here's the thing. This is the amazing part of that scripture that I want you to understand. God causes all things to work together for good for those who love the Lord. If you don't know Him, you've never given your life to Him, you're not His child. That scripture does not say God causes all things to work together for good, period. If you don't know Him, you know what He causes all things to work together for? To work together to cause you to seek Him. You know what's happening in our world right now? People are questioning their eternity. Because I know so-and-so who was perfectly fine, and they got sick, and in a week they were dead. Nobody ever expected that. I could be next. Suddenly people are beginning to question their eternity. They're beginning to look at their eternity and go, what's going to happen? What if tomorrow I'm told I have the virus? You know, it's crazy. We talk about this virus like it's the most incredible disease that we've ever seen. On a daily basis, people are told, you have cancer. And it's inoperable. On a daily basis, people are told, you have some type of heart disease, and your heart's dying, and there's nothing we can do about it. People are told all kinds of things that are medical issues that are going on in their life on a daily basis. But for some reason, because we have become used to that, it didn't scare them into wondering, what about my eternity? Now suddenly this brand new thing has come along and it has terrified people, and they began to search for their eternity. They've turned on the computer and they've went purposefully to websites and watched messages. On Mother's Day alone, our Facebook live broadcast had over 500 people that tuned in and watched the service. We don't have 500 people attend here in 5 weeks. Over 500 people tuned in and watched the service, and we have between 200 and 300 people that are averagely watching the service. Right now, we don't have that many people come in the door, but they're searching for something. Why? Because there are things that are happening they don't understand, and they're left with, what do I do? And the only thing they can do is look to God. He's causing all things to work together that they might seek Him. For those of us that know him, listen, should we be terrified of this virus? No. Should we use common sense and try to do things to protect ourselves? Absolutely. We should do that. Do you love God? That's the big question for the day. God causes all things to work together for good for those who love God. So the question is, do you love him? Do you love him? Has there ever been a time in your life where you gave your life to him? Has there been a time when you realized, I'm a sinner, I need a Savior, because my eternity says that if I die in my sin, I will spend an eternity in hell? That's what Scripture tells us. If we die in our sin, never having asked forgiveness, never giving our life to God, then we will spend an eternity in hell. And if I'm thinking that, and I know I need a Savior, has there ever been a time when you said, I know I need a Savior, and I want you to come into my life, Jesus, and forgive me of my sins? Because I know the Scripture says that when Jesus died on the cross and his blood was shed for me, that if I accepted that salvation, then I have been granted salvation from that sin. Even though I have still committed the sin, I have been given forgiveness and I have been granted salvation, and now I'm looking forward to an eternity in heaven with my Lord and Savior. Has there been a time when that's happened in your life? If there's been a time when that's happened in your life, then listen to me. God causes all things to work together for good, but there are bad things that we go through. While we're going through these bad things, listen, you know what we can do good? We can share with people that don't know the love of Christ. We can share with people who are struggling with racism and they're struggling with all those things, that God loves everyone and that we can be that light that he's called us to be in this world. We can share with people who are struggling with total fear of this disease that, you know what? God can answer even that. Because if you know him and you've given your life to him, even if this virus takes your life, you're promised an eternity in paradise with him if you know him. The fear, the anger, all of the things that are going on in the world today, the answer is God. Amen? The answer is God. Do you know him today? If you came in here today because, you know what, you've been wondering about all of this stuff and this was a church you saw that was open, so you came, then listen, today what you've heard is that you need God. And if you have never given your life to him, you need to do that today. You'll have an opportunity. In just a moment, we're going to have a time of invitation. When we have this time of invitation, here's what I want you to understand. That's a time when you examine your life, you look inside yourself, and you say to yourself, do I love God? Have I ever given my life to him? Not have I ever been a member of a church anywhere. There are members on church rolls all over our country that when the end time comes and Jesus comes back, they will never see paradise because they didn't know him. They simply put their name on a church roll somewhere. That's not enough. Today, you need to examine your life. You need to know, do I know him? He has a purpose, and his purpose and everything he works together for good for those who love the Lord. Do you love him? Do you know him? If you know him today, then share that love with people around you that may not know. If you don't know him today, then we're going to have a time of invitation. I'm going to have a prayer, and then we're going to have a time of invitation, and I encourage you, come talk to me. And I will share with you how you can know him today. How you can be assured that you can spend an eternity in paradise with him. And no longer will hell and death and all those things be something that will scare you. Because you know God has worked it together for good. Let's pray. Father, we come to you today. And we do thank you so much for the blessings that you give. God, we know, Father, that you are in control. But God, we do know that there are things that aren't good. They seem so bad in this world, but God, you work those together for good for those who love the Lord. Father, I pray that today you will help every single one of us examine our hearts, Father, and if we come to an understanding that we don't know you, that today, God, you would call us to yourself. Father, if there are those that are here that say they know you, but God, they've not lived their life in a way that shows your love to the people around them, then God, I pray that today you would cause them to repent and give themselves back to you according to your purpose. Not ours, but yours be done. Father, we ask all these things in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen. Won't you stand? If God's put it on your heart that you need to come, you come now. If God's put it on your heart that you need to come and spend some time at the altar, in whatever reason that you need to do that, the altar is open. Please come. I'm going to put my mask back on, so if anybody wants to come, you don't feel uncomfortable about coming. You come on and talk to me.
Take my life, lead me, Lord. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Make my life useful to Thee. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Take my
Again, remember that there's no evening service, no Wednesday night service. We will meet back here next Sunday morning, 10:45. And I'm so glad that you're here today. Remember that this has been broadcast on Facebook Live. And so if there are those who were not able to be here, you can let them know that it is available, that they can go out and watch it. Listen, until we get together again next week, I want to ask you this. I want to ask you to look in your life. Seek through those things that you have deemed bad in your life and then see what God did with those things for good. What an amazing journey that is when you stop and think about it. So we're going to go ahead and pray and dismiss. And fathers, again, happy Father's Day. If your father is where you can reach out to him, please do so. And just enjoy the rest of the day. I know that Max, you're here. I don't know if Brother Ed's here, but we had a deacons meeting scheduled for this afternoon. It's going to be postponed. We'll let you know when it's going to be rescheduled for, and I'll get with Brother Hugh and let him know about that as well, okay? All right, let's pray. Father, we do come.